Achette Audio presents The Puppet Show, written by M.W. Craven and read by John Banks. The stone circle is an ancient, tranquil place. Its stones are silent sentinels, unmoving watchers. Their granite glistens with the morning dew. They have withstood a thousand and more winters, and although they are weathered and worn, they have never yielded to time, the seasons, or man. Alone in the circle, surrounded by soft shadows, stands an old man. His face is heavily lined, and lank grey hair frames his bald and mottled scalp. He is cadaverously thin, and his gaunt frame is racked by tremors. His head is bowed, and his shoulders are stooped. He is naked, and he is about to die. Strong wire secures him to an iron girder. It bites into his skin. He doesn't care. His tormentor has already tortured him. He is in shock and thinks he has no more capacity for pain. He is wrong. "Look at me," his tormentor's voice is flat. The old man has been smeared with a jelly-like substance that reeks of petrol. He raises his head and looks to the hooded figure in front of him. His tormentor holds an American Zippo lighter. And now the fear kicks in. The primal fear of fire. He knows what's going to happen, and he knows he can't stop it. His breathing becomes shallow and erratic. The Zippo is raised to his eyes. The old man sees the simple beauty of it, the perfect lines, the exact engineering, a design that hasn't changed in a century. With a flick, the top flips open. A turn of the thumb, and the wheel strikes the flint. A shower of sparks, and the flame appears. His tormentor lowers the Zippo, drags the flame down. The accelerant catches. The hungry flames flare, then crawl down his arm. The pain is immediate, like his blood has turned to acid. His eyes widen in horror, and every muscle goes rigid. His hands clench into a fist. He tries to scream, but it dies when it reaches the obstacle in his throat. Becomes pitiful and muted as he gargles his own blood. His flesh spits and sizzles like meat in a hot oven. Blood, fat, and water roll down his arms and drip from his fingers. Black fills his vision. The pain fades. His breathing is no longer rushed and urgent. The old man dies. He doesn't know that his own fat will fuel the fire long after the accelerant has burnt away. He doesn't see how the flames burn and distort what has been carved into his chest. But it happens anyway. Chapter 1. 1 week later. Tilly Bradshaw had a problem. She didn't like problems. Her low tolerance for uncertainty meant they made her anxious. She looked around to see if there was anyone to share her findings with, but the serious crime analysis section office was empty. She checked her watch and saw it was coming up to midnight. She'd worked for 16 hours straight again. She thumbed her mother a text, apologizing for not calling her. She turned back to her screen. Although she knew it wasn't a glitch, with results like these, there would be an expectation that she had triple-checked. She ran her program again. After making herself a fruit tea, she glanced at the progress bar to see how long she had to wait. 15 minutes. Bradshaw opened her personal laptop, plugged in her headphones, and typed, "back at keyboard." Within seconds, she was fully immersed in Dragon Lore, a multiplayer online role-playing game. In the background, her program processed the data she'd entered. Bradshaw didn't check the SCAS computer once. She didn't make mistakes. 15 minutes later, the National Crime Agency logo dissolved and the same results appeared. She typed, "away from keyboard," and logged out of her game. There were two possibilities. Either the results were accurate, or a mathematically implausible coincidence had occurred. When she'd first seen the results, she'd calculated the odds of it happening by chance and had come up with a number in the high millions. In case she was asked, she entered the maths problem into a program of her own design and ran it. The result popped up and showed it was within the margin of error she'd allowed. She didn't smile when she realized that she'd worked it out faster than her own computer, using a program she'd written. Bradshaw wasn't sure what to do next. Her boss, Detective Inspector Stephanie Flynn, was usually nice to her, but it had only been the week before when they'd had their little chat about when it was appropriate to call her at home. She was only allowed to ring when it was important. But as it was D.I. Flynn who decided if something was important, how was she supposed to know without asking her? It was all very confusing. Bradshaw wished it were a maths problem. She understood maths. She didn't understand Detective Inspector Flynn. She bit her lip, then came to a decision. She reviewed her findings and practiced what to say. Her discovery related to SCAS's latest target, a man the press were calling the Immolation Man. Whoever he was, and they'd made an early assumption he was male, he didn't seem to like men in their 60s and 70s. In fact, he disliked them so much, he was setting them on fire. It was the third and latest victim's data that Bradshaw had been studying. SCAS had been brought in after the second. As well as identifying the emergence of serial killers and serial rapists, their role was also to provide analytical support to any police force undertaking complex or apparently motiveless murder investigations. The Immolation Man certainly ticked all the SCAS boxes. Because the fire had destroyed the bodies to the point they didn't even look like bodies, a post-mortem wasn't the only approach the SIO, the senior investigating officer up in Cumbria, had taken. He'd sought advice from SCAS. After the post-mortem, SCAS had arranged for the body to go through a multi-slice computed tomography machine. The MSCT was a sophisticated medical investigative technique. It used X-ray beams and a liquid dye to form a 3D image of the body. It was meant for the living, but was just as effective on the dead. SCAS didn't have the resources to have their own MSCT. No law enforcement agency did, but they had an agreement to purchase time on one when the situation merited it. As the Immolation Man left no trace evidence at the murder scenes or abduction sites, the SIO had been willing to try anything. Bradshaw took a deep breath and dialed D.I. Flynn. The phone answered on the fifth ring. A groggy voice answered.
Hello?
She checked her watch to confirm it was after midnight, before saying,
Good morning, Detective Inspector Flynn. How are you?
As well as talking to her about when it was appropriate to ring her after hours, D.I. Flynn had also urged her to be politer to her colleagues.
Tilly, Flynn grumbled. What do you want? I want to talk to you about the case, Detective Inspector Flynn.
Flynn sighed.
Can you just call me Stephanie, Tilly? Or Steph, or Boss? In fact, we're not that far away from London. I'll even accept Gov. Of course, Detective Inspector Stephanie Flynn. No, I mean, can you not just... Oh, it doesn't matter.
Bradshaw waited for Flynn to finish before saying,
May I please tell you what I've found?
Flynn groaned.
What time is it? The time is 13 minutes past midnight. Go on, then. What's so important it couldn't wait until the morning?
Flynn listened to her before asking a few questions and hanging up. Bradshaw sat back in her chair and smiled. She'd been right to call her. D.I. Flynn had said so. Flynn was there within half an hour. Her blonde hair was tangled. She wore no makeup. Bradshaw wore no makeup either, although that was by choice. She thought it was silly. Bradshaw pressed some keys and brought up a series of cross-sections.
They're all of the torso, she said.
She then went on to explain what the MSCT did.
It can identify wounds and fractures that the post-mortem might miss. It is particularly useful when the victim has been badly burned.
Flynn knew all this, but let her finish anyway. Bradshaw gave up information in her own time and wouldn't be rushed.
The cross-sections don't really give us that much, D.I. Stephanie Flynn, but watch this.
Bradshaw brought up a composite image, this time from above.
What on earth?
Flynn asked, staring at the screen.
Wounds, Bradshaw replied. Lots of them.
So, the post-mortem missed a load of random slashes.
Bradshaw shook her head.
That is what I thought.
She pressed a button and they studied the 3D image of the wounds on the victim's chest. The program sorted through the seemingly random slashes. Eventually, they all came together. They stared at the final image. There was nothing random about it.
What do we do now, Detective Inspector Flynn?
Flynn paused before answering.
Have you called your mum to explain why you aren't home yet?
I sent her a text.
Well, send her another one. Tell her you won't be back tonight.
Bradshaw began tapping the screen of her mobile.
What reason shall I give?
Tell her we're getting the director out of bed.
Chapter 2. Washington Poe had enjoyed his day repairing the dry stone wall. It was one of several new skills he'd learned since moving back to Cumbria. It was back-breaking work, but the reward of a pie and pint at the end of the day was all the sweeter for it. He loaded his tools and a few spare rocks into his quad's trailer, whistled for Edgar, his Springer Spaniel, and then began the drive back to his croft. He'd been working on the outer boundary wall today, so was over a mile from his home, a rough stone building called the Herdwick Croft. It would take him 15 minutes or so to get back. The spring sun was low, and the evening dew made the grass and heather shine. Birds chirped territorial and mating songs, and the air was fragrant with early flowers. Poe breathed in deeply as he drove. He could get used to this. He had been planning on a quick shower, then a walk over to the hotel, but the closer to home he got, the thought of a long soak in the bath with a good book was far more appealing. He crested the last peak and stopped. Someone was sitting at his outdoor table. He opened the canvas bag he always carried with him and removed a pair of binoculars. He trained them on the lone figure. He couldn't be sure, but the person looked female. He increased the magnification and smiled grimly when he recognized the figure with the long blonde hair. So, they'd finally caught up with him. He put the binoculars back in his bag and drove down to see his old sergeant.
Long time no see, Steph, Poe said. What brings you this far north?
Edgar, the furry traitor, was fussing round her like a long-lost friend.
Poe, she acknowledged. Nice beard.
He reached up and scratched his chin. He'd got out of the habit of daily shaves.
You know I've never been good at small talk, Steph.
Flynn nodded.
This is a hard place to find.
She was wearing a trouser suit, navy blue with pinstripes, and judging by how lean and supple she looked, she'd obviously kept up to date with her martial arts training. She exuded the confidence of someone in control. A pair of reading glasses lay folded beside a file on the table. It looked like she'd been working before he'd arrived.
Not hard enough, apparently, he replied.
He didn't smile.
What can I do for you, Sergeant Flynn?
It's Detective Inspector now, although it couldn't possibly make the slightest bit of difference.
Poe raised his eyebrows.
My old job?
She nodded.
I'm surprised Talbot allowed you to take it, Poe said.
Talbot had been the director when Poe had been Eskass's Detective Inspector. He was a petty man, and he'd have blamed Flynn for what happened just as much as he blamed Poe. More so, perhaps, Poe hadn't hung around. She had.
It's Edward Van Zyl now. Talbot didn't survive the fallout.
Good man. I like him,
Poe grunted. When Van Zyl was in Northwest Special Branch, they'd worked closely together on a counter-terrorism case. The July 21st bombers had trained in the Lake District, and Cumbrian cops were vital in building up the intelligence profile. It had been Van Zyl who asked Poe to apply for the SCAS position.
And Hansen?
Still the deputy director.
Pity, said Poe.
Hansen was a politically savvy man, and Poe wasn't surprised to learn he'd somehow managed to wriggle out of it. Ordinarily, when a senior manager is forced out due to catastrophic errors in judgment, the next manager in line takes their job. That Hansen hadn't been promoted meant he'd not got away with it completely. Poe could still remember the smirk on Hansen's face when he suspended him. He hadn't had contact with anyone from the NCA since. He'd left no forwarding address, had cancelled his mobile phone contract, and, as far as he knew, he wasn't on any database in Cumbria. If Flynn had taken the trouble to track him down, it meant a decision on his employment had finally been made. As Hansen was still in post, Poe doubted it was good news. It didn't matter. He'd moved on months ago. If Flynn was there to tell him he no longer worked for the NCA, then that was fine. And if she were there to tell him that Hansen had finally found a way to charge him with a criminal offense, he would just have to deal with it. There was no point shooting the messenger. He doubted Flynn wanted to be there. "You want a brew? I'm having one." He didn't wait for a response and disappeared into the croft. He shut the door behind him. 5 minutes later, he was back with a metal espresso maker and a separate pot of boiled water. He filled two mugs. "Still taking it black?" She nodded and took a sip. She smiled and raised the mug in appreciation. "How do you find me?" His face was serious. His privacy had become increasingly important to him.
"Van Zyl knew you'd come back to Cumbria, and he knew roughly where you lived. Some quarry workers told me there was someone living in an old shepherd's croft in the middle of nowhere. They'd been watching you do the place up."
She looked round, as if evidence of this was negligible. Herdwick Croft looked as though it had grown out of the ground. The walls were made of unrendered stone, too big for any one man to lift and manoeuvre into place, and it merged seamlessly with the ancient moorland it inhabited. It was squat and ugly, and looked like it had been frozen in time for 200 years. Poe loved it. Flynn said,
"I've been here a couple of hours, waiting."
"What do you want?"
Flynn reached into her briefcase and pulled out a thick file. She didn't open it.
"I assume you've heard of the immolation man."
Poe jerked his head up. He hadn't expected her to say that. And of course he'd heard of the immolation man. Even in the middle of the Shap Fells, the immolation man was news. He'd been burning men to death in some of Cumbria's many stone circles. 3 victims so far, unless there was another he hadn't heard about. Although the press had been speculating, the facts were there if you knew how to separate them from the sensationalism. The county had its first ever serial killer. Even if Eskass had been called in to help Cumbria police, he was on suspension, subject to an internal investigation and an IPCC inquiry. Although Poe knew he was an asset to any investigation, he wasn't irreplaceable. Eskass had moved on without him.
So what was Flynn really doing there? "Van Zyl's lifted your suspension. He wants you working the case. You'll be my DS."
Although Poe's face was a mask, his mind worked faster than a computer. It didn't make sense. Flynn was a new DI, and the last thing she'd want would be the old DI working under her, undermining her authority just by being there. And she'd known him a long time, and knew how he responded to authority. Why would she want to be a part of that? She'd been ordered to. Poe noticed she'd made no mention of the IPCC inquiry, so presumably that was still ongoing. He stood and cleared away the mugs.
"Not interested," he said.
She seemed surprised by his answer. He didn't know why. The NCA had washed their hands of him.
"Do you want to see what's in my file?" she asked.
"I don't care," he replied.
He no longer missed Eskass. While it had taken him a long time to get used to the slower pace of life on the Cumbrian Fells, he didn't want to give it up. If Flynn wasn't there to sack or arrest him, then he wasn't interested in anything else she had to say. Catching serial killers was no longer a part of his life.
"Okay," she said.
She stood up. She was tall, and their eyes were on the same level.
"I need you to sign 2 bits of paper for me, then."
She removed a thinner file from her briefcase and passed it over.
"What's this?"
You heard me say Van Zyl's lifted your suspension, right?
Nodding, he read the document.
Ah.
And you realize that as you're now officially a serving police officer again, if you refuse to come back to work, it's a sackable offense. But rather than go through all that, I've been told I can accept your resignation now. I've taken the liberty of getting HR to draw up this document.
Poe studied the one-page sheet. If he signed at the bottom, he was no longer a police officer. Although he'd been expecting it for a while, he found it wasn't as easy to say goodbye as he thought. If he did sign, it would draw a line under the last 18 months. He could start living. But he'd never carry a warrant card again.
He glanced at Edgar. The spaniel was soaking up the last of the sun. Most of the surrounding land was his. Was he ready to give all this up?
Poe took her pen and scrawled his name across the bottom. He handed it back so she could check he hadn't simply written "piss off" on the bottom. Now that her bluff had been called, she seemed less sure of what to do next. It wasn't going to plan. Poe took the mugs and coffee pot inside. A minute later, he was back outside. Flynn hadn't moved.
What's up, Steph?
What are you doing, Poe? You loved being a cop. What's changed?
He ignored her. With the decision made, he just wanted her to go.
Where's the other document?
Excuse me?
You said you had two things for me to sign. I've signed your resignation letter, so unless you've got two of them, there's still something else.
She was all business again. Opening the file, she removed the second document. It was a bit thicker than the first and had the official seal of the NCA across the top. She launched into a rehearsed speech. It was one Poe had used himself.
Washington Poe, please read this document and then sign at the bottom to confirm you've been served.
She handed over the thick sheaf of paper. Poe glanced at the top sheet. It was an Osman warning.
Oh, shit.
Chapter 3.
When the police have intelligence that someone is in significant and immediate danger, they have a duty of care to warn the victim. The Osman warning is the official process for discharging that duty. Potential victims can consider the protective measures being proposed by the police, or if they aren't happy, they can make their own arrangements. Poe scanned the first page, but it was full of officious bullshit. It didn't say who he was at risk from.
What's this about, Steph?
I can only tell you if you're still a serving police officer, Poe.
She handed him the resignation letter he'd just signed. He didn't take it.
Poe, look at me.
She held his gaze, and he saw nothing but honesty in her eyes.
Trust me. You need to see what's in this file. If you don't like it, you can always email Hanson your notice later.
She handed him back his resignation letter. Poe nodded and tore up the letter.
Good, she said.
She passed across some glossy photographs. They were of a crime scene.
Do you recognize these?
Poe studied them. They were of a dead body, blackened, charred, almost unrecognizable as a human being. Shrunken, as anything primarily made of liquid is after exposure to extreme heat. The corpse looked as though it had the same texture and weight as the charcoal Poe removed from his wood-burning stove every morning. He could almost feel the residual heat through the image.
Do you know which one this was? Flynn asked.
Poe didn't answer. He flicked through the sheaf of photos, searching for a point of reference. The last one was a shot of the whole crime scene. He recognized the stone circle.
This is Long Meg and her daughters. This,
he pointed at the first photograph,
must be Michael James, the Tory councillor. He was the third victim.
It is. Staked in the middle of the stone circle, covered in accelerant, then set on fire. His burns were over 90%. What else do you know?
Only what I've read. I expect the police were surprised at the location. It's not as rural as the other two.
Not half as surprised as they were at how he'd successfully managed to evade every bit of surveillance they'd put in place.
Poe nodded. The immolation man had chosen a different stone circle each time he killed. It was how the press had come up with the name. Immolation meant sacrificing by burning, and with no other motive, the press jumped on it. Poe would have expected the police to be watching all the circles. Then again, maybe not. There were a lot of stone circles in Cumbria. Add the barrows, henges, and standing stones, and you'd have nearly 500 to watch. Even if they used minimal surveillance details, they'd need a team numbering close to 2,000 cops. Cumbria barely had 1,000 badged officers as it was. They'd have no choice but to pick and choose where they put their limited resources. He passed the photographs back. As gruesome as it all was, it didn't explain why Flynn had made the long journey north.
I still don't understand what this has to do with me.
She ignored the question. Eskas were called in after the immolation man's second victim. The SIO wanted a profile. It was to be expected. It was the unit's speciality.
Which we did, she continued. Came up with nothing usable. The usual stuff about age ranges and ethnicity, that type of thing.
Poe knew that profiles could add value, but only when they were part of a multi-strand investigation. He doubted they were talking because of a profile.
Have you heard of multi-slice computed tomography?
Yes,
he lied.
It's where a machine photographs the body in very thin slices rather than as a whole. It's an expensive process, but sometimes it identifies anti- and post-mortem injuries that the conventional forensic post-mortem has missed.
Poe had been very much a need-to-know-what-it-can-do rather than a need-to-know-how-it-works kind of guy. If Flynn said it was possible, then it was possible.
The post-mortem found nothing, but the MSCT found this.
Retrieving another set of photographs, she placed them on the table in front of him. They were computerized images of what appeared to be random slashes.
These were on the third victim, he asked.
She nodded.
On the torso. Everything he does is designed for maximum impact.
The immolation man was a sadist. Poe didn't need a fancy profile to tell him that. He studied each page as Flynn turned them over. There were nearly 20, but it was the last one that caused him to gasp. It was the sum of all the parts. The computer image where all the random slashes came together to form the picture you were meant to see. Poe's mouth turned to glue.
Ow, he croaked.
Flynn shrugged.
We were hoping you could tell us.
They stared at the last photograph. The immolation man had carved two words into the victim's chest. Washington Poe. Chapter 4.
Poe sat down heavily. Blood leached from his face. A vein in his temple began pounding. He stared at the computerized mock-up of his name. And it wasn't just his name. Above it had been carved the number 5. That wasn't good. That wasn't good at all.
We're interested in why he felt the need to carve your name into the victim's chest.
And it's not something he's done before. It's not something that's been held back from the press.
Nope. We've retrospectively put victims 1 and 2 through the MSCT, and they're clear.
And the number 5?
There was only one plausible explanation, and he knew Flynn agreed. It was why she'd issued the Osman warning.
We assume you're earmarked as the 5th victim.
He picked up the last photograph. After the crude attempt at the number 5, the immolation man had given up on curves. All the letter strokes were straight. Although they were only looking at a computer image, Poe could see the wounds were too crude for a scalpel. His money was on a Stanley knife or similar. The fact that the letters had been picked up by the MSCT meant two things. They were anti-mortem. If they hadn't been, the post-mortem examination would have found them. And they were deep. The burning would have destroyed shallower wounds. The victim's last few minutes must have been hell on earth.
Why me? Poe said.
He'd spent a career making enemies, but he hadn't worked a case involving someone this nutty before. Flynn shrugged.
As you can imagine, you're not the first person to ask that question.
I wasn't lying when I said I only know what's been reported in the papers.
We know that when you were a Cumbria police officer, you had no official contact with any of the victims. I'm assuming you hadn't had any unofficial contact with them.
Not that I know of.
He gestured to the croft and surrounding land.
This place takes up most of my time these days.
That's what we assumed. We don't think the link is the victims. We think the link is with the killer.
You think I know the immolation man?
We think he knows you, or knows of you. We doubt you know him.
Poe knew that this was the first of many discussions and meetings, and that whether he wanted to or not, he was involved. In what capacity was still up for debate.
First impressions? Flynn asked.
He studied the slash marks again. Not including the messy number 5, he counted 42. 42 wounds to spell out Washington Poe. 42 individual expressions of agony.
Other than the victim wishing I'd been called Bob,
nothing. I need you to come back to work, she said. She looked around at the desolate fells he now called home. I need you to rejoin the human race.
He stood up, all previous thoughts of resigning dismissed. There was only one thing that mattered. The immolation man was out there somewhere, selecting victim number 4. If he ever wanted to feel at ease again, he had to find him before he reached number 5.
Whose car are we taking? He asked.
Chapter 5. As soon as they were out of Cumbria, the land flattened and the M6 stretched ahead like a runway. Spring was having delusions of summer grandeur, and Poe found himself having to turn up Flynn's air conditioning. Sweat pooled in the small of his back. It had little to do with the heat. An uneasy silence had stifled them. When Poe had dropped off Edgar with his nearest neighbor, Flynn had changed out of her crisp power suit into a more casual outfit of jeans and a jumper, but despite her relaxed attire, she twirled her fingers through her long hair as she stared at the road.
Congratulations on your promotion, Poe said.
She turned her head.
I didn't want your job. You must know that.
I do. And for what it's worth, I think you'll make an excellent DI.
He wasn't being spiteful. She relaxed and said,
Thank you. You being suspended wasn't exactly how I envisioned getting a DI position, though.
They had no choice.
They might not have had a choice when they suspended you, Flynn said, but anyone could have made that mistake.
Doesn't matter, he replied. We both know there's a clear evolutionary line from that mistake to what happened, Steph.
Flynn was referring to their last case, his last case. A madman in the Thames Valley area had abducted and killed 2 women, and Muriel Bristow, a 14-year-old girl, was missing. SCAS had been involved from the beginning. Offender profiles and crime mapping had been completed, but it was the geographic profile that led them to their main suspect, Peyton Williams, an MP's aide. Everything fit. He had a previous conviction for stalking, was in the area every time a girl had been abducted, and had a string of failed relationships. Poe wanted to arrest and question him, but his boss, Director of Intelligence Talbot, had refused. A general election had been called, and they were in the pre-election period known as Purda. Without evidence, arresting an MP's aide in a marginal seat could be viewed as election tampering. At least it could in Talbot's eyes.
Go and find something solid, he'd been told.
In the meantime, Talbot told Poe he would inform the MP in question. Tell him they were investigating a member of his staff. Poe begged him not to. Talbot ignored him. The MP fired his aide and told him why. Poe was furious. Peyton Williams wasn't going to go anywhere near Muriel Bristow now, not with that kind of attention. If she were still alive, she wouldn't be for much longer. She'd die of dehydration. He wasn't the type of cop who'd palm off the unpleasant tasks to others. He'd made the trip to the family's home himself. Before he left, he printed off a family liaison case summary,
a heavily sanitized account of what was happening in the investigation. After telling the Bristows what he could, he handed over the file for them to review in their own time. And later that day, all hell broke loose. Poe had made a mistake, a terrible mistake. As well as printing off the family liaison case summary, he printed off an updated summary for his own file. This one wasn't sanitized. It contained all his suspicions and all his frustrations. The wrong report had ended up in the wrong file. The Bristows got to read all about Peyton Williams. Only later, after Williams had been snatched and tortured by Muriel Bristow's father, and long after he'd given up Muriel's location and she'd been safely returned to her family, did anyone stop to think how Bristow even knew about Peyton Williams at all? The mistake had been quickly uncovered, and despite Poe having been right all along, and despite an innocent girl being returned to her family, he'd been suspended with immediate effect. A few weeks later, Peyton Williams died of his wounds. Until Flynn had showed up at Herdwick Croft, Poe hadn't seen anyone from the NCA since.
"You disappeared without saying goodbye to anyone," said Flynn. He felt a tinge of guilt. When he'd been suspended, Poe had ignored all the texts and voicemails offering support. A man had been tortured, and he'd been responsible. He'd had to learn to live with that. He'd returned home to Cumbria, got away from his well-meaning colleagues, hid away from the world, alone with only dark thoughts for company. Flynn continued. "Between you and me, Van Zyl told me he thinks the IPCC aren't far off finding a no case to answer. They can't prove it was definitely you who put the wrong report in the family's file." The thought offered Poe no comfort. Perhaps he was getting used to his monastic existence. He opened the case file and began reading everything Eskass had on the immolation man. Chapter 6. Although it was a triple murder and the documentation was copious, Poe had seen enough files to locate the important stuff. He went straight to the senior investigating officer's early description of the first crime scene. These were often the most useful as they contained first impressions. Later reports were more measured and considered. The SIO was a detective chief superintendent called Ian Gamble. Normally, the force major incident team would lead on something that big, but they were in the middle of another investigation. So Gamble, who was also head of CID, appointed himself, and given the media attention Cumbria was getting, it seemed a sensible move. Gamble had been a detective inspector when Poe knew him, a solid copper who ran tight, if unimaginative, investigations. He was the one who'd noticed a chemical smell above the obvious one of petrol at the first scene. His suspicions had been well-founded. The immolation man had used a homemade accelerant. No wonder the bodies had been turned to charcoal. "Scary, isn't it?" said Flynn. "Apparently, all you need to do is add bits of chopped styrofoam to petrol until it won't dissolve anymore. The boffins at tech support say the result is a white, jelly-like substance that will burn so hot it'll render down fat. When that happens, the body acts as its own fuel and burns until there's no flesh and bone left."
"Dear God," Poe whispered.
Prior to joining the police, he'd served for 3 years with the Scottish infantry regiment, the Black Watch, and had trained with white phosphorus grenades. He imagined the results would have been similar. Once it was on you, it wasn't coming off. The best you could hope for was that your flesh fell off. If it didn't, it kept burning. The first victim had been killed 4 months ago. Graham Russell had started his newspaper career in a local Cumbrian rag 40 years earlier, but had soon moved to Fleet Street. There, he rose to be the editor of a national tabloid heavily criticized during the Leveson inquiry. He hadn't personally been implicated in anything, but he'd taken a massive pension and retired to Cumbria anyway. The immolation man had abducted him from his small country estate. There had been no sign of a struggle, and sometime later he'd been found in the middle of Castle Rigg Stone Circle near Keswick. As well as being burnt to a crisp, he'd been tortured. Poe frowned as he followed the team's early lines of inquiry.
"Tunnel vision?" he asked Flynn.
Inexperienced SIOs sometimes saw things that weren't there,
and although Gamble was hardly a junior officer, he hadn't run a murder investigation for some time.
We think so, though they're denying it, obviously, she replied. But DCS Gamble seemed pretty keen on the first murder being a Leveson revenge crime.
It wasn't until a month later, when the body of Joe Lowell was discovered, that the TIE inquiries, trace, interview, eliminate, stopped focusing on phone hacking victims. Lowell had never been involved in the newspaper trade. He was from a family of landowners who'd farmed South Cumbria for seven generations. The Lowells were, and always had been, solid and popular members of the community. He'd been taken from Lowell Hall, the family home. Despite his son living with him, no one reported him missing. His body was found in the middle of Swinside Stone Circle near Broughton in Furness in South Cumbria. Consequently, the investigation got even more serious. All thoughts of Leveson were forgotten, to the point the murder file was amended, and the focus turned to where it had always been heading, a serial murderer investigation. Poe searched the file for the section on stone circles. With the killer seeming to have a connection to them, Gamble would have collated as much information as he could. Cumbria had the highest concentration of stone circles, standing stones, henge monuments, monoliths, and barrows in the UK. They were all unique and from a range of time periods, from early Neolithic to Bronze Age. Some were oval and some were round. Some of the stones were pink granite and others were slate. A small number had an inner circle of smaller stones. Most of them didn't. Gamble had brought in academics to brief the team on their probable purpose, but this was less than useful. Theories range from death ceremonies and trade routes to an intimate association with the lunar cycle and astronomical alignments. The only thing academia seemed to agree on was that, in the entire history of stone circles, they had never been used for ritual sacrifice. Of course, Poe thought, tomorrow's history is written today. Chapter 7. Poe was reading about the third murder, Michael James, the South Lakes councillor who died 2 weeks ago with Poe's name carved into his chest, when he came across a document that made him laugh out loud. It had been written by one of the detective sergeants on the case, and he was the only man who could get away with describing the smell at the crime scene as having a miasmatic quality to it. He was one of life's clowns, but he was also one of the most intelligent men Poe had ever met. The type of man who could win a game of Connect Four in three moves. His name was Killian Reed, and he was also the only real friend Poe had in Cumbria. They'd met in their early teens and had been close ever since. He felt a pang of guilt he hadn't looked him up since he got back. He'd been so wrapped up in his own problems, it hadn't occurred to him. Saying that, he and Reed had known each other a long time and had far too much history for them to ever really fall out. Poe borrowed Flynn's phone and opened the dictionary app. He typed in miasmatic. It meant noxious vapors from decomposing organic matter. He wondered how many people before him had been forced to do the same. It was Reed all over. Getting one over on senior managers by making them feel stupid. No wonder he was still a sergeant. Things were looking better if they were going to be working together again. Poe picked up the rest of the file and read on. After the second victim had been found and SCAS were called in, Flynn's name began to appear in reports. The second victim also started a media race to name the killer. In the end, as they always did in matters like this, the Red Tops won with Immolation Man. He finished his first read-through and put down the file on the rear seats. He closed his eyes and rolled his neck. He'd read the file again soon, every document. Get it imprinted on his memory. The first time was simply to get a flavor of what he was dealing with. SCAS were rarely called in immediately, so reviewing files like they were cold cases was an important skill. They weren't just looking at the evidence, they were looking for mistakes the investigating teams had made. Flynn noticed he'd finished reading and said, "Thoughts?" Poe knew he was being tested. He'd been away for a year. She and Van Zyl needed to know he was still up to the job.
"The circles and the immolations are probably a dead end. They'll mean something to the killer, but we won't find out what until after he's caught,"
He has an idea of what he wants, but he's happy to change if the reality doesn't live up to the fantasy.
How so?
The first victim was tortured. The others weren't. For some reason, that didn't do for him what he thought it would. So he stopped doing it.
Michael James had your name carved onto his chest. Seems like torture to me.
No. He put that on for a reason we don't know yet. The pain he caused was incidental. Graham Russell's pain was intentional. Flynn nodded for him to continue. All the men are in the same age group, and they're all wealthy. You found nothing to suggest they knew each other.
You think he's choosing them at random?
Poe didn't, but he wasn't ready to say why yet. He needed more information. He wants us to think he is. She nodded, but said nothing. And none of them were reported missing? Poe asked.
Nope. They all seemed to have genuine reasons to be away from home. It wasn't until after they were killed that we discovered the lengths the immolation man went to make sure they wouldn't be reported missing.
How? Poe knew it was in the file, but sometimes it was better to get an interpretation of the facts.
Graham Russell's car and passport were logged getting onto a ferry, and his family got emails saying he was holidaying in France. Joe Lowell sent his family texts from Norfolk saying he was staying with friends and he'd be shooting red-legged partridges until the season ended. Michael James lived on his own, so wouldn't have been immediately missed, but his computer history still showed he'd been planning a bespoke whiskey tour of the Scottish Isles.
So you can't be sure when any of them were taken?
Not really, no.
He thought about what that meant and decided all it did was confirm what he already knew. The immolation man was well organized, he told Flynn.
How so? He leaves a chaotic crime scene.
Poe shook his head. She was still testing him. He's in control at the crime scene. No improvisation. Everything he needs, he brings with him. No physical evidence at the abduction sites or the murder sites. And given that evidence transfer is inevitable and retrieval techniques have never been better, that's remarkable. By the third victim, there was a fair bit of surveillance on the stone circles, I gather.
Most of them. The one at Long Meg had only just been lifted.
So, he's also surveillance aware, Poe said.
Anything else?
Have I passed? Flynn smiled.
Anything else?
Yes. There's something missing from the files. A control filter, something the SIO is holding back from the media. What is it?
How did you know?
The immolation man might not be a sadist, but he's acting sadistically. There's no way he leaves the bodies unmolested.
Flynn pointed at her briefcase on the back seat. There's another file in there.
He leaned across and retrieved it. It was stamped secret, and someone had written, not to be shared without written permission from DCS Gamble. Poe didn't open it.
Have you heard of the cutting season, Poe?
He shook his head. He hadn't.
It was originally coined by the NHS. It refers to the time of year, the summer holidays usually, when young girls, some as young as 2 months old, are taken out of the UK, ostensibly to visit relatives abroad. What they're going for is to undergo female genital mutilation. They go in the long summer break, so their wounds have a chance of healing before they return. Poe knew a little about FGM, the abhorrent practice of removing parts of a young girl's genitals to ensure she can't experience sexual pleasure. It was believed to keep them faithful and chaste. The reality was that the victims had a lifetime of pain and medical problems. In some cultures, the wounds were still stitched together with thorns. It dawned on Poe why Flynn was telling him this.
He's castrating them.
Technically, no. He cuts off the veg and the meat, neatly and without anaesthetic.
He's keeping trophies, Poe said.
A high percentage of serial murderers kept parts of their victims. Actually, he isn't. Open the file.
Poe did, and nearly lost his lunch. The first photograph explained why the victim's screams hadn't been heard.
He'd been gagged.
The photograph was a close-up picture of Graham Russell's mouth. It was stuffed with his own genitals. The next few photos showed the penis, testicles, and scrotum, which were still attached to each other after they'd been removed from the mouth. Blackened at the end, exposed to the fire, surprisingly pink and undamaged at the other. Poe flipped through the rest of the photographs and found them to be much the same. And he was supposed to be the fifth victim, as if the stakes hadn't been high enough already. He crossed his legs.
We'll get him before he gets anywhere near you, Poe.
Chapter 8. Deep in the heart of Hampshire, in the grounds of the old Bramshill Police College, lies Foxley Hall. The college might have seen its last course, but Foxley Hall was still the home of the serious crime analysis section. For a unit that tended to avoid attention and work in the shadows, the building itself was surprisingly quirky. It was wider than it was tall, had sloping roofs that almost touched the ground, so it looked like Eskass worked in an abandoned Pizza Hut. Flynn had spent the night at home. Poe had checked into a hotel. He'd had a fitful night. His nightmares had returned. When he'd been working, the dead had always stayed with Poe. They messed with his dreams, and they interrupted his peace. Being back in Hampshire had reopened old wounds. Despite what he'd done, Peyton Williams hadn't deserved to die. During the early hearings, Poe had been shown photographs of the injuries Mr. Bristow had inflicted upon Williams. Teeth removed with pliers, spiral fractures to all his fingers, the punctured spleen that would eventually kill him. It had been 6 months before Poe managed to get a full night's sleep. And now, the nightmares were back. Perhaps they'd never gone away. It was 8 o'clock in the morning, and Poe had to be escorted into Foxley Hall as if he were an official visitor. The receptionist's bored look changed to one of sycophancy when she saw her boss. She handed Flynn some mail and looked at Poe rudely.
"And you are?" Poe asked, glaring back.
He might be wearing jeans and look more mountain man than cop, but she was about to learn that Eskass had a sergeant again. The receptionist looked like she had no intention of answering unless she was told she had to. That was the problem in areas with high employment. No one took their job seriously anymore. It was little more than pin money.
"I'd answer him if I were you, Diane,"
Flynn said, as she rifled through the letters she'd just been handed.
"This is D.S. Poe, and you'd better believe he's not going to take your shit."
Instead, Diane smirked and said,
"Deputy Director Hansen is waiting for you in your office."
"Is he now?"
she sighed.
"You'd better stay out of his way, Poe. He still blames you for not getting the director's job."
Hansen had never taken responsibility for his own failings. Not being promoted had to be either someone else's fault or part of a wider conspiracy against him. That he'd backed Talbot in the Peyton Williams case was neither here nor there.
"Glad to," Poe replied.
Flynn turned to Diane.
"Go and get D.S. Poe a cup of coffee. Do that, and he'll be your friend for life."
Poe and Diane looked at each other. Both doubted that, but Poe was in no mood for a fight this early. Flynn went off to see Hansen, and Diane led Poe across the open-plan office to the kitchen area. As she poured him some filter coffee, Poe surveyed the office he used to manage. Things had changed. When he'd been the detective inspector, the tables were arranged depending on wherever people fancied sitting that day, and because of inter-office politics, the office layout was constantly changing. Even though he'd known that had irritated Flynn, he hadn't intervened. If she'd wanted order, she could have put her sergeant's stripes to use. But now, with her inspector's pip, she'd decided to use her management authority. Analysts, some of whom he recognized, most of whom he didn't, were seated around an ordered central hub. It acted as the center of a wheel, with officers and specialist pods forming the spokes. It wasn't quite a cubicle farm, but it wasn't far off. There was a low hum of noise, muffled phone conversations, the clack of keyboards, and the shuffle of paperwork. Despite it being early, no one was eating breakfast at their desks. That had been another thing that had made Flynn's bile bubble. people arriving at work, then spending 30 minutes making porridge. Eskas might have been functioning professionally and efficiently, but to Poe, it had about as much charm as an out-of-office email. If he were forced to spend time there, he knew that within an hour he'd be using the word fuck like a comma. At least his large map of the United Kingdom was still there. Poe wandered over and scanned it. It dominated the wall. Different color markers laid over it like weather patterns indicated where the various crimes were on their radar. If the colors were the same, it suggested there was enough evidence that the crimes might be linked. Analysts were constantly scanning the media and crime reports from the territorial forces, looking for patterns and anomalies. Part of what Eskas did was crying wolf, seeing patterns and letting police forces know they might have a serial rapist or murderer. Most of the time, they were wrong. Sometimes, they were right. There were three red markers in Cumbria. The immolation man was being worked hard. A hush rippled across the room as people began to realize who had walked in with the boss. Poe heard his name being whispered. He ignored it. He hated being the center of attention, but he knew he was a cause célèbre. Not just because his name had been carved into the chest of a man sleeping in a cold bed at Carlisle's mortuary, but also because of the way he'd run the unit when he was in charge. And the way he'd left, he shouldn't forget that. The silence was broken by muffled shouting. It was coming from his old office, technically Flynn's office now. Poe wandered over. Although most of the shouting was indistinct, Poe heard his name every now and then. He opened the door and eased inside. Hansen leaned over Flynn's desk. Both his hands were planted knuckles down on the wood.
"I told you, Flynn, I don't care what the director said, you shouldn't have reinstated him."
Flynn was taking it calmly. "Technically, Director Van Zyl reinstated him, not me." Hansen stood up.
"I'm disappointed in you, Flynn."
Poe coughed. Hansen turned.
"Poe," he said, "I didn't realize you'd traveled back with D.I. Flynn."
"Good morning, sir," Poe said.
Hansen ignored his outstretched hand. Poe knew he should care that the deputy despised him, but he found not giving a shit was far easier. When you didn't care about your job, the people in authority quickly realized just how little power they had.
"Smile all you want, Poe. Van Zyl's made a mistake reappointing you. You'll fuck up again and he'll go the same way as the last director."
He turned to Flynn.
"And when he's gone, there are going to be some big changes around here, D.I. Flynn."
Without a further word, he left the office, king of the token gesture. He couldn't resist slamming the door. Flynn had arranged a meeting with Human Resources. The sooner Poe could be formally reinstated, the sooner they could both get back up to Cumbria. A senior HR officer was on his way down to the Eskas building. They took a seat at the small conference table and waited. Poe took the time to look at what Flynn had done with his old office. Before he'd sneaked in, he'd noticed the highly polished brass plate with Flynn's name. Poe had had a sheet of A4 with his details written in flipboard marker pen. Blue, if he remembered correctly. The chaos in which he'd worked had been replaced by a sense of calm and order. Blackstone's police manuals were lined up on the shelf. Right at the end was her well-thumbed copy of the Senior Investigating Officer's Handbook. Poe had owned a copy of the pocket-sized book. All detectives did.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.